You're listening to the AfterBuzz TV Network, now the largest new media platform on the web, and your number one source for after-show entertainment. The AfterBuzz Studios in Los Angeles, California. Presented by Maria Menounos and streaming live thanks to Akamai Technologies. This is AfterBuzz TV's Helix After Show. We'll break down tonight's episode and get you all the latest news and gossip. And now, another post-game wrap-up show for your favorite TV show. It's AfterBuzz TV's Helix After Show.
Hey there, Helix fans. Ooh, let's just let that groove sink in. We're here at AfterBuzz TV talking about episodes 101 and 102, Pilot and Vector. I am Matt Lieberman. I'm going to be hosting all season long with my fabulous panel. We have the fantastic and lovely Miss Liz Rishmawi.
Hey, guys.
And the fantastic and talented Mr. Zach Wilson.
Howdy doody.
Our hilarious and brilliant engineer and co-host, Mr. Stephen Lemieux.
Hey guys, how's it going today? Yes. Good.
Yes. So this show, man.
Oh my god, this show.
I've never seen anything like it. Like even Zach, before the show, you were asking me like, is this a series or is this a mini series? I'm like, it's a series. Like I don't know how they're gonna sustain this scenario with this level of suspense with characters already getting virused.
I mean, it's a mystery sci-fi show, right? So yeah. We have to assume there's more to the puzzle that we haven't gotten yet.
It's true. And it's almost kind of like a weird quasi-Lost setup where we've got people journeying to this place, remote place, they can't escape. There's a mysterious evil that's kind of sweeping down upon people and interrupting the status quo. And we've got some 120 souls in the entire facility, which means that we...
121.
Yes, which means that we can introduce new characters as we go along who have been there the whole time.
That's
just
true.
For whatever reason, they just didn't play up in importance.
Yeah.
But let's break it down. So we start 2 days ago. We start on since it's aired on Friday. We started last Wednesday.
Started. Yeah. When stuff started going down.
Yeah. We've got Dr. Hakate, and I think his lackey, his security lackey,
Daniel.
Fat Daniel.
Daniel. And that haircut, though.
And I don't fat shame because I'm chubby. I used to be far chubbier. But he's a dick, so I need something. We need to identify him in some way.
Seriously. He's even the way he was like talking to them at that one point, he was just like, you know, it's so rude. They're just asking basic questions. He's got to be such a jerk about it. You know?
There are no monkeys.
There are no monkeys.
Can we just classify him as bad casting?
Yeah.
I didn't think he was bad.
He was bad guy casting.
Exactly the amount of jerk he needed to be.
Yeah, but as like a head of security, like really?
Well, it's a very specific kind of head of security. He was adopted by Dr. Hakate when he was a boy and trained forever to be his lackey.
Okay, he isn't very.
I mean, yeah.
He isn't very,
like, think of Igor.
Yeah, he's not very threatening.
No. But he's loyal. And
he
that's
could survive
important.
The Arctic winter.
Yes, he could. Well, no. Hey, it's important to have someone that fat on your staff just in case you need to cut him open and sleep inside him like a tauntaun.
Am I the only person who didn't think he was like that fat, or have I just like never
nope.
left this country?
Nope.
So that's
average. No, you are the only person who doesn't think he's.
Oh,
that.
I'll just say that like quarantine suits are not very.
Flattering,
yeah. Yes.
Yes.
Well, he was running around like what, like a sweater vest outfit?
Something like that.
I wouldn't call him hot. Maybe lukewarm.
Oh, God.
It's a tauntaun joke.
I know. You're campaigning for a puncher on the show.
I can't afford the puncher.
I know. On this show, you definitely can't. So this show comes from a great sci-fi pedigree. Obviously, Ronald D. Moore, who created and ran Battlestar Galactica on sci-fi for 4 seasons. He's an executive producer on the show, created by a writer named Cameron Persanda. A couple of great writers and producers on the show, Linda Opes, Javier Grillo Markswatch. I don't know how exactly to pronounce his name. He was a writer and producer on Lost. He created the amazing short-lived The Middleman, which was on ABC Family like 5-6 years ago, which was a really cool show based on his comic. And so we've got Dr. Hakate and Fat Dan, and they come into this ruined lab, and we've got our two dead guys and poor Peter Farragut.
Oh, God.
Who just wants to escape, and they give him some water, which he does not want.
No.
He does not want water, and the water makes his throat start convulsing.
Total foreshadowing. I don't know. What do you guys... I don't know. I think I remember we were watching it together with Steven, and Steven thought maybe it was some sort of, like... Oh, we know it's a contaminant. Is this like, is it based after like water? What'd you say, Steven? It was like,
well, you know, what it reminds me of is there's a, what is it called? A parasite.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And the parasite, it's, we see it a lot on the TV shows now. They lay the eggs in the moth or whatever, the wasp, and it grows inside, or it's a fungus that grows inside them and it avoids water.
Oh.
And, it goes towards water, which is different.
Yeah.
But anyway, it makes people try to go towards more people to spread itself.
Right.
Okay. Yeah, and that's kind of what we're seeing here in this show. And like the water just kind of reminded me of, okay, all the blood is black. He's giving the guy water. Maybe it needs water to thrive.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, because there's definitely, like you said earlier in the show, there's like some evil lurking.
Yeah.
But there's just some people are just up to no
good. We don't know what's up with this virus. We know that it's compelling people to spread it. Which is why the monkeys fled en masse from the oh my god, the
monkeys.
Were they
running towards civilization or running away from people?
Well, that's the big question. Are they running towards civilization? Because they could have spread the disease just as easily inside the facility. Mm-hmm. Or were they running away because they'd become hyper intelligent and realized that this was not the place to be if they wanted to survive?
Or is it? It could be that the virus hacks into a sort of like what the intelligence level of the creature is.
Mm-hmm.
So taking over like how much a monkey is capable of. A monkey, it thinks, escape, get towards more Reese's monkeys, which is not here.
Right.
They go to escape, whereas hacking into Peter's brain, mm-hmm. now he knows, I'm not going to get out of here that easily.
Oh,
I need
yeah.
to commandeer some kind of helicopter. I need to find a way out, not
yeah.
just...
But
run.
Can we go back to talking about the relationship? Because the whole...
Yes.
I mean, I don't want to skip ahead to the end of the episode yet. But...
Thank you. Thank you, Liz, for keeping us on point.
Yes.
Because we have so much speculation to do about the nature of this virus and
yeah.
what it's going to do.
Oh, yeah.
But let's talk about... So we got Alan, Peter, and Julia. Alan and Julia used to be married. Stephen Lemieux saw that she was his ex-wife from a mile away the moment she got on.
Like, literally
within the first 3 seconds,
yeah.
he's like ex-wife.
Yeah,
the stare.
Which, like, you know, these tropes, they're classic for a reason. It's good it's good archetypes. It's good storytelling. You know, you've got it already builds some tension into it because Alan's not going to be on his game. You know, there's going to be tension over what to do about Peter. We don't know necessarily what caused her to sleep with Peter, why she would betray Alan in such a way. She obviously feels very bad about it. It only happened the one time, it seems.
Yeah.
She kept on mentioning about how, like, she's beating herself up for the both of them and,
yeah.
you know.
And Dr. Hakate has a weird stalker binder of photos of her, so he's obsessed with her,
oh,
too.
My God.
And I'm wondering if, like, somehow he brainwashed Peter years ago or brainwashed Julia to sleep with Peter to get her out of her marriage to Alan, and that's like way
Whoa.
In left field.
Whoa, man.
I know.
I'm gonna roll that theory back up and stick
oh,
it back in my
but
backpack.
But that being said, like, we got that photto, like, stalker thing really early when we had no other indication he was connected.
Oh, yeah.
Other than, like, you know, his just kind of general demeanor around her. He was just like, maybe it's just because he's Japanese, but I'm just like, he's like examining a flower. So beautiful, so fragile, so brilliant. No one really appreciates you like I do. You know, what if...
Kept on thinking that he was going to break out into like a haiku or something. He just said that soft, gentle,
yeah,
delicate.
Well, I love Hiroyuki Sanada. He's such a great actor.
Oh, yeah.
And it's so cool to see him get a role this juicy.
Because,
you know, usually, like in movies, a lot of the times he's exposition guy, you know. He hasn't really had
He's the mean guy to,
yeah.
like, come in and make trouble for the hero.
Right, but he doesn't get to sink into something, like sadistic or anything like that. And this guy, you know, the tagline of the show, play God, pay the price. So obviously he's trying to play God to some degree. And he's got weird eyes. We don't
oh
know what's
God.
Up with that. Steven, you look like you need to say something.
Honestly, no, I was just thinking of Hatake haikus.
Oh, okay.
I am going to infect you. I will infect you.
Yeah.
The virus is very strong. I'm stalking your wife.
Yeah,
that that's very good.
Yes.
Oh. That was beautiful.
Took talent.
I'm just imagining while none of us was like paying attention to him, if he was just like in the corner, like counting his syllables.
Yeah, I will infect you with viruses.
But what about and then this whole thing with like Sarah being the younger girl, Jordan. She
Sarah Jordan.
The young hottie.
Yeah, she's just the whole though obviousness is like as soon as you see that first scene with Alan and they're all like I mean there's totally gonna be tension there, so that's then, why you knew the ex-wife was gonna be in there to like have that trifecta,
right? And then like, you know, she totally calls Sarah out on it immediately in the pilot, which is like it's basically the show's way of saying we know it's obvious, but this is a lot of compressed time.
Oh yeah.
If every episode is going to be another day in this situation, you know, and it's only like maybe 13 episodes a year, we have to get a lot of this off the ground early. We can't have them naturally fall in love. There has to be feelings already in play.
And how could she not with that nice deep gravelly voice?
Oh yes.
I'm the doctor.
He's the man.
I'm with you people. I'm going to take off the suit.
He's so sensitive.
I'm a fracking doctor.
Yeah. Someone said frack. Oh, yeah. Doreen was the one who said fracking early in the episode. I'm like, what?
Doreen?
Yeah.
Oh, you mean Pam.
Oh, you mean Pam. Yeah.
We've been calling her Pam because of Archer. But no, I wanted to actually build on what you just said about how they don't have a lot of time, so they're really kind of getting the main points out of the way. They're like, hey, here's a bunch of main points. So when you're watching the rest of the series, you don't hate us because we're just throwing main points every episode. The whole beginning of the episode with 2 days later is a huge tee up for the season. His whole speech when he throws the cholera. So I'm going to tie two things into this.
Please.
So he tees it up with, you're going to see things that are beyond your comprehension, that are worse than anything you've ever seen before. You're going to have to sacrifice family. You're going to have to sacrifice friends. And you're going to have to sacrifice hundreds of people or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
So this show, I'm definitely sensing that we're going to see a lot of things with people who are dear, like main characters getting infected, dying, things like that.
A lot of death, a lot of sacrifice.
And there, I can see a lot of moral choice where somebody's going to have to make a choice. Okay, do we let these people out or do we kill these, let these people die because they're in this room with this infected person?
Mm.
And again, with the water, I just thought of this. Mm-hmm. And what is the first story that Matt's he tells? He tells the story of the cholera in New York, which was being spread by water, which was that rusty, like, handle.
Yeah.
So, right.
And why was there monkey hair in the sink?
Well, you got to bathe the monkeys.
Well, like, I mean, I guess. But, I mean, it's like, were they trying to get to water?
But,
I
again, mean, it's water playing a role in solving some of these clues, finding clues.
Spreading something. Yeah. And then it's through saliva or it could be through liquid. I mean,
through
you never
this black goo, which we still don't know what it is. And I 100% agree with it. I love this scene. It is a mission statement for the series. It is, we're going to see people making difficult choices. They're never going to be the same. This is a horror show. Mm-hmm. This is a horror thriller show. And I don't know that I've ever seen anything like it, where we've got people in an enclosed space trying to survive indefinitely. And every single day will be accounted for, which makes the 2 days between the prologue and when we first meet Alan Farragut all the more important, because when he's told that they're supposed to go up to this research facility, he's told that that the head doctor there, Dr. Hakate, wants him there to check out the situation. But when Dr. Hakate is talking later, he says he didn't want them there.
Yeah, I was just about to bring that up. So, like, who called? Because, I mean, all the people in this facility, it seems like there's only very few people who are actually in on, like, what's going on. We don't know who Dr. Hakate works for.
Mm-hmm.
We know that, did we bring him up yet? Sergio? He's the systems engineer who's supposedly from the Army.
Mm-hmm.
And we see him put, like, a satellite out to, like, open up a connection to
encrypted back channel to someone mysterious.
And we don't know who.
I assume the military.
But, yeah.
That was my first thought. It was because, like, if something, an installation this big, I assume the military is concerned.
Mm-hmm.
They want to know what they're doing there if they don't have somebody inside already, or if he's their mole inside now.
could be the military that they're, you know, that they're working for. I mean, this is some sort of contaminant. They what was the phrase they put for it? Someone created the perfect
contagion machine.
Contagion machine. So, you know, I think it was Steven or Matt, maybe it was you. Someone said, "Oh, of course, it could be like the government. They would want to control over like this perfectly."
Yeah, it's you know, the perfect weapon. You know, a nuclear bomb. You launch it. It can be stopped in the air. You can blow it up in the air, and it can only kill so many people. This is something that could kill.
It's controlled.
Everyone.
Oh yeah.
Especially if you can come up with an antitoxin. So that you can control how many people it kills and save your own people.
Also have those two versions, too. There's the one that kills, which was, I think, the first part was the A.
Oh, yeah.
And then there was B.
Right.
I'm guessing the two guys who worked in the lab with him had the first one that killed them, and then now everybody else who's walking around infected got infected.
No.
No?
What it says, and they're reading his notes, he gave himself 2 cc's of A, and he gave himself 4 cc's of B. So he got both of them.
Okay.
So you gotta wonder, like, there's a reason that he would infect himself with A, because honestly, they were using this drug to test it. So he would know that it kills the mice.
I thought they used it on the mice, though, when they were going over those records with the 2 cc's and stuff.
Yeah, but they were just recreating his experiments to see it.
Oh, yeah.
So he would know that it kills the mice.
Yeah.
So the thing you got to wonder is, what is the benefit of A that they were trying to get out of the experiment, and is B what prevents that? But there's side effects to B that A were supposed to prevent.
Here's what I imagine. What if they were contracted by the government to create A, which is a perfect weapon, something they could use to surgically wipe out portions of the population, an ultimate fail-safe in war, the ultimate chemical weapon. But Dr. Hatake went too far and was like, what if we could take it further and make something even better?
Hmm.
You know, when he looks over Peter, and he says, you know, this is progress. Like, this is what he's working towards. They finally have reached the step where it doesn't just kill, it makes humans better.
I mean, every army in fiction, at least, is looking for that super soldier serum.
Yeah.
They're looking for a way to enhance, to give people special abilities and, like, give them an advantage over the enemy. And if this is the type of virus that turns them into... I don't think we've used this word yet, a zombie-like creature, which is sort of like we're dealing with a sort of intelligent zombie. If they're unkillable,
they
get shot and keep going or something of the sort.
Yeah, but there's no guns. And I remember someone kept on pointing out that there's no guns. So I wonder, and that's the other, going back to the thing, if it's a weapon for the government, like, but how is it that the government would be able to control anybody who is contaminated? Because I understand how, if it's killing people, maybe that benefits them, but once they're out and just trying to infect everybody, like, what's to say stop them from infecting people who the government doesn't want?
Well, as we've learned, the mastermind is Hatake.
Yeah.
Okay? The mastermind is Hatake, and he's not human. So
we don't know what he is.
Okay, he's not human.
He's Super Saiyan.
The reason we were saying earlier that you believed that they revealed him looking at the thing too soon.
Yeah,
that was the end of the first episode, I believe.
Because it was the end of the second episode.
Yes.
Wait, you've been looking.
It was a two-part episode.
Yeah. So was that at the same time when he revealed the eyes?
Yes.
Okay, so that was the end of the two-part. Where was the end of the pilot within this?
The end of the pilot was when Peter. Used the RFID scanner in the guy's hand to access a door. That was the end of the first episode.
Okay, so it wasn't when he looked up and saw each other?
Mm-mm.
Okay, that's why I was confused. I was confused where each episode ended, because we watched the hour and a half
together.
Uncut long one. Premiere, yeah.
Fast forward through commercials. I have no idea. Yeah.
So what we were talking about...
Well, Dr. Hitaki, we saw his eyes light up. Yeah. And I mean, my wild theory is, I think he's infected in a next evolution of the virus.
Ah.
And like, if you think of it, if it's an intelligent virus that is, its main directive is to spread.
Yeah.
Its main directive is to create more.
So
as
that's why
with the
he's
mouse,
developed it.
Yeah, he's taking it, if it's really hacked into his intelligence, or if he's just a creature from God knows where, he is now just forced into working towards spreading through whatever means, in this case, through science.
The other thing that I had, based on what you just said, I was, is the whole thing, am I allowed to bring this up now? The end of the episode, well, we know that Peter...
As long as it took place in the episode, you can bring it up.
Oh, yeah. Peter had some sort of, like, he seems to still have this infatuation with Julia.
Yeah.
Even after everything's happened, we know that there was a video that Alan had watched saying that he was still dating T. Mm-hmm. We don't know who T is. We don't know if it's an initial for someone or maybe he was just coding it.
He wants the T.
And, you know, and then, and you know, going back to him saying, oh, I don't know if I can ever have a relationship. And then... Apparently, there's an obsession between Hitake, and then there's an obsession that Peter still has. And I wonder if somehow Hitake and Peter, maybe this vial shares the same like brainwaves or patterns. Like they're they.
Well, anyone who gets infected starts talking as a we instead of an I. And I'm wondering if it kind of creates this almost like hive mind. I'm like thinking about like Ender's Game and the and the bugs in that, and oh, how God, they have this hive mind. And I'm wondering, once you're infected, do you get plugged into this collective thought consciousness, which is so large from the collective thinking power of everyone that it infects that it makes the group collectively more intelligent.
Yes. And who's the, I mean, they keep, I know the people, once they get infected, they're super paranoid.
Yeah.
But it's like, are they paranoid for a reason? Who are the liars? If this is some sort of hive mind, it's like, is Hitake the liar? Is it the humans?
He's definitely a liar.
Well, yes. But I mean, like, I wonder if that's actual real paranoia or if it's the virus thing speaking out and like, who, you know, what is it talking about?
Yes.
Well, if it's this intelligent, who knows what kind of false flags it's planting. I mean, we have the couple of people who are holed up. They're put into isolation because mm-hmm. the two guys, the woman, and two of them, one guy is clearly infected, and he's sort of like fighting it more than anybody else that we've seen. He's like resisting, telling them to get out. The other two are just like, we don't know what's going on. But do they, like, there's this huge scientific facility.
Yeah.
What are they all doing there?
Oh, yeah. There's only, like, a few key people who really seem to know what the heck is going on.
Or are willing to reveal it. Because, you know, we have this video of Peter, right, where he's talking about T, and he's doing this tell, which he did whenever he was nervous. Whenever he was nervous because he and Alan's father was a drunk and he would beat them and all this stuff.
Well, the men run.
Yeah,
that was run, like,
run like hell.
Yeah. Run like hell.
Yeah, to anyone watch, to Alan, if you somehow watch this, maybe he somehow knew that Alan was going to come eventually.
Well, he knows his brother works for the CDC. If this is a virus, he has to assume.
He requested Dr. Walker, who I thought was Julia.
It is Julia. But here's Julia was the first person notified. She brought Alan in specifically because it's Peter who was infected. Here's what I'm thinking. What if Peter infected himself with B to make the CDC come so that it could be stopped? He was trying to interrupt the research, and he sacrificed himself to do it.
Wow, I didn't even think about that. That's pretty good.
If he's still in control, he could legitimately be trying to stop them.
Yeah.
But now they're fighting him, thinking he's out of control.
And he's also fighting his own impulse to spread the virus.
And he also did totally infect Julia at the end
of this. Well, that's what I'm saying. Was that conscious? Did he want to do that? Or was that the mental want of, I want Julia, I love her, I miss her, combined with this new biological imperative, I must spread this disease?
That's true. Because I think at the beginning, when she was backing away, you know, he seemed to be very tender toward her. He wasn't just viciously attacking her as soon as he saw her.
Yeah.
And then as soon as she did try to break away, he went into like flippy monster mode and just like gnarled her face.
Although she was like about ready to kiss him at that point. She wanted it. For a moment.
What? No.
There was totally
you should see Stephen Lemieux's face right now.
There was
she wanted it.
What? She wants the V. She wants the virus.
Not totally. Not as there was a hesitation. Like, she didn't just run. Like, there was, if you look, there was like a little quiver, like she almost wanted to kiss him.
Yeah,
a little
bit of the quiver before you realize, oh yeah, this is my lover. Oh, Eddie's infected. did. No, like, come on.
I don't even see that.
But it was there.
As the only woman on this panel, yes. I will let you guys know that if I'm stark naked in a shower in some place where there's like a contaminant running around,
sure.
And this dude with his eye all twitchy and bloodshot and a black vein sticking out comes all, Julia.
Sure.
I'm just trying to get the hell away from you without making you like,
I would just be mad that he. I would just be mad that he called you the wrong name.
Yeah.
Yeah, your name is not Julia. That would be messed up. I'm going to take this break as an opportunity to talk about iTunes because, oh my God, we're 25 minutes into this podcast.
What is iTunes?
Well, I'll tell you, Steven. It is an application developed by One Apple Inc. where one can download fine podcasts such as this one for the low, low price of how much, Steven?
I think right now it's free.
What?
Free. My free God. Podcasts.
And they're actually free one, get one free.
Oh my God.
Oh my God.
That's a great deal.
Download one for free, get another one for free, and then download the rest for free. This is an incredible, incredible bargain.
I have to go find my phone, guys.
Yes. It's like happy hour 24 hours a day.
All silliness aside, here at AfterBuzz TV, we put out over 60 hours of content a week. It's a crazy amount of content. It's all free. This podcast is free. You're listening to it because you wanted to, and you didn't have to pay a dime to do so. And I would hope that you would appreciate that and you'd think like, oh man, you know what? I'm a lucky guy. I'm a lucky gal. I get to download a great podcast talking about my new favorite show, Helix. What can I do to help the cause and keep this gravy train a-flowing? I will tell you. If you could go to iTunes, this is super important, folks. I really, really mean it. It means the world. Go back to iTunes, go to the page with the show, give us a rating, maybe 5 stars if you think the show is worth 5 stars. And give us a review. Let us know how we're doing. What points could we address better? Who would you like to see on our show if we can get a special guest? What do you want to see happen on Helix? We want to know. We want to know. And here's the thing, folks. Every rating that you give us helps make the show searchable. This is so crucial. We want to be the number one Helix podcast on the web, and only you can help us do it. I really, really appreciate it. AfterBuzz TV has the best fans in the whole world.
You guys are the best.
And if you're in California, you can, you know.
Oh, yeah. Quick.
Oh, it's happy music. That means something bad's going to happen.
I know. It's behind me.
Dance.
All right, now that our commercial break is over.
Yes, so back to Helix. All right, so I want to talk about Doreen and Sergio and Mungus!
Oh my God, Monksicles.
I know.
That sounds like religious people. Frozen.
I love this creepy monkey. Creepy monkey my favorite monkey.
And can I just,
creepy CGI monkey?
Can I just say, though, how this woman, Doreen, her name is Doreen Boyle. Did anybody catch exactly what her exact specialty was?
I believe she's a zoologist.
Yeah, like they said, yeah, because they made that joke about her being a veterinarian. So yeah. Here's my thing, though. They're walking around. They're trying to look for these monkeys, right?
Yeah.
They're not wearing any suits.
No.
And it's like, dude, like, you know better, lady. Like, you know better. You're looking for the monkey. You see the monkey. You know there's some sort of virus. You know the monkeys were probably infected. And right. She's just like, hey, handsome guy.
Hey. We know it's not airborne, so let's get rid of all protection and all safeguards at all.
Exactly. Oh.
In fact, let's just breathe extra deep just in case.
You know, just let's make kissy faces at the ravenous, hairless monkey that's just like in a cage.
It looks like this animal left the cage from the inside.
Yeah, so it should be friendly.
Let's approach it in a dark, dank space.
Yeah, with a flashlight and instigate a confrontation. Here's the thing, folks. First thing I'm going to say, I love monkeys. I love monkeys. If we can get more monkeys on this show.
Can we have a monkey as a guest?
I would kill to have a monkey on this show.
Oh, my God.
I would kill to have a monkey on this show. I love monkeys. The more monkeys we get on the show, the better. It will definitely get an Emmy if we get monkeys every episode.
Yes.
But this monkey, right, totally jumps on her face like an alien face hugger.
Mm-hmm.
And we don't know for sure. It's inconclusive about whether or not he spat any black stuff into her mouth. There's no scratches on her face.
Which I found weird.
Yeah. She doesn't seem to be exhibiting any symptoms yet. And
she's not infected. I'm just going to say it right now. We would have seen it by now.
Yeah.
We would have seen some change, and she wouldn't have been okay that whole time when she's dealing with someone sneaking up on her.
Well,
and
here's
like
what
that.
I'm wondering. What if what she got spat into, if she got something spat into her mouth, if she got something spat into her mouth, then it could be something completely different from B.
I'm sorry.
It could be a completely different thing. It could be some kind of retrovirus that could counteract it, and she could be the key to saving everybody, which would be really, really funny because it's Doreen.
I think you've taken a large leap of faith there.
A very large leap.
But can we say, though, that so far from what we know in the show, if she did get contaminated at all, she is the only one that we know of so far who has gotten contaminated, not directly from injecting the virus into her and not from getting it from another human.
True.
And I would like to also take this opportunity to point out there is a part in the show, I believe it's Sarah and Julia finds that this is the smallest known virus trace.
Oh, yeah, and it could be an ancient virus.
9 nanometers, and it's like a little tapewormy looking thing.
Yeah, like 15 or something. All right,
there's 25.
Relevant. It was super, super tiny, and that made me think, well, you know, hell, I don't know biology, I don't know science, but is it possible because it's so tiny that it doesn't necessarily, it's not airborne, but that it doesn't necessarily need an open wound to, like, get in or something?
It's entirely
possible. Think, right?
Yeah.
Like, trying, that size, you know?
If she is not, I mean, obviously she's not infected because we kind of know she's not infected. I mean, bear claws boost the immune system. I mean, bad jokes. But no. I don't think she's infected because I think her character has a different purpose than that.
Yeah.
Like the way they're building her up, she's not going to be someone who's going to get infected so easily.
No, she's got that sassy, like funny.
Yeah, she's got
relief.
The comic relief, and she's probably going to be the one that they're going to put in lots of dangerous situations, but everyone but her gets killed.
Oh, yeah.
Things like that. Yeah. And she's probably going to be the one that has to make a really hard decision.
I like her.
Totally.
Well, she just goes off, and even when she's dissecting the monkey, it seems like she hasn't contacted anybody.
Mm. Yeah, she's a lone wolf.
Peter's on the loose at this point. Nobody's like, we should put a guard on her. Mm. We should check in. Nobody's checking in with Doreen.
Okay, I got to say this, though. It irked me so much.
What?
Okay, when she saw the monkey die, she saw the neck thing, and she was like, oh, that's weird. But then she's dissecting it, and the first thing she does is, like, intestines.
Ooh.
And I'm like, it looked like somebody very first time dissecting something. Oh, intestines. Like, oh,
right, yeah, no, why not look at the neck first?
Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
I'm like, oh, this is interesting. Better look at that.
And why not tell them about the neck when she finally does make contact?
You guys, this is the woman who did put her open face toward a cage of a monkey that ripped the lock from the inside
That's
out.
True.
Hi, handsome boy.
But it's not airborne. It's not airborne.
But he was a handsome boy. He was a handsome boy. Handsome. Also,
oh my
God.
How many of you guys saw Hotel Rwanda? That scene? No, just the scene where he walks out and he sees all the frozen monkeys in the road. He's like, he's out in the snow, and it's just white, and just like in a scene from Hotel Rwanda, it's all white around him, it's just foggy, and then all of a sudden he discovers the bodies of all these people in the road, and that's totally what happened with these frozen monkeys.
Okay, you were treading a fine line there, my friend.
Yeah,
I know. Dead monkey field.
Yeah.
I have nothing. I just keep thinking about those monkeys' faces, like
poor
frozen.
Monkeys.
Guys, honestly, there's not going to be more monkeys.
I want more monkeys!
All of them are dead. All of
what
them.
What if Doreen turns into a monkey?
Oh my God, what if Doreen turns into a monkey?
That'd be great.
Not going to turn
Well,
into
then
a monkey,
the writers are going to be fired, most likely. There's no more monkeys because they all ran under the snow, and then that
Fine.
Was probably the last one.
Yeah.
And they found the last one.
Okay.
But you just got to imagine, like, monkeys are supposed to be able to expand, like, 80% of their musculature. They're supposed to be able to use so much more because they evolved that way. So they have monkeys here. What if they were trying to
splice monkey genes into human DNA?
Yeah,
they
something
did say
like
they were
that.
Trying to work with mutagens.
Yeah.
But then I think he got called out, like, you weren't working. I think it was Julia. She was talking to.
She's like, you weren't working with mutagens.
Yeah.
Or Peter wasn't.
Or, yeah, no, yeah. Something like that.
Well,
and then he refuses to tell what's going on. So I wonder what episode is it going to be when we finally figure out like what exactly they were trying to make?
Yeah. Well, the monkeys are in the transgenetics section.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So I'm assuming that is referring to a trans species.
Yeah, cross species genetics. They're obviously trying to splice something into someone else. We don't know if the virus was specifically to do that purpose or if they were working on a lot of different things and this is the first thing that got bad. We
maybe
also
they're splicing 28 days later into a TV series.
Yeah, maybe. well, we also have this mysterious white room where obviously very bad things happen. No one likes to talk about it, but all of the employees know that it exists. So
and he goes with white eyes, kind of, Mr. Hatake.
Ooh, maybe. All right, I want to just ask what is this? Maybe we should just go right into predictions because we just have so many questions.
Did we cover the whole episode yet? Like, I mean, did we cover everything?
I know there's so much plot. There was a lot of wandering around in tunnels, but
we have time, Matt. So there's no rush at all. Let's go over.
How much time do we have?
I mean, as long as we need.
Great. I've been rushed out a lot recently.
Oh, yeah. Sorry about that. Oh, no. I want to talk about, is her name Sarah?
Yeah, let's talk about Sarah the and cutie containment. Patootie. Oh, my God. So cute.
The QT3.14. No.
Super smart, too.
That's an internet
term. She's also brilliant. She's got 2 master's degrees and a PhD.
And she's 26.
Back up. Yeah. She's the youngest doctor ever hired by the CDC. So back up.
I got a PhD hired by the CDC. Yeah, I can't finish that. That's anyway, I want to talk about her because she's kind of developing a lot of the moral things right here because she's locked in the room with the people and they're trying to get out and she ends up as a hostage with a freaking thing to her throat.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So like she's going through a lot and she's also kind of on the fence because apparently, what's his name? Farragut?
Yeah, Dr. Alan Farragut.
Alan just wants to take off his helmet everywhere and get infected. And she's just like all about not doing that.
Alan just wants to take off his helmet and sigh
and be your
everywhere.
Friend.
He
be
just wants to...
I'm here with you.
Billy Campbell. I'm charming but tired.
Look,
all the time.
You guys could be infected. But I'm going to show solidarity by taking my helmet off.
Why does he have a Batman voice? You sound like Batman.
But you got to say... I might be infected now that I'm in this room for you, but she won't take her helmet off. But the next scene you see will be me and her both with our helmets off in the same room.
This is a terrible Billy Campbell impression. This is like, he sounds like a flasher when you do it.
Camera jump.
Despite the creepy Batman that we just got out of Stephen Lemieux, it's a good point, though.
Dr. Alan Batman.
Rachel.
Oh, God.
Rachel.
Where's Sarah?
Oh, God. Wait, can I just say, though, big props to Sarah, though, because even when those guys in the room, I don't know his name, like random white guy with a beard, number one, who is holding up this, like, whatever it was, the syringe of something to her. And the first thing she said was, I don't care what you do to me, but you are not getting out of this room.
Yeah.
So just going to say props to her. And I think that's going to come in handy later. You have this like really cute, petite looking, smart scientist girl, but
who
she's
has
at
steely
least
resolve.
She at least has some bravery, which I hope
I'd say she has more balls than, you know, even Alan. Like that like she was faced with imminent danger. I mean, so was he.
She had a syringe needle full of something that could have killed her, and he took off his helmet. Like, what was a little
it was
bit
morphine.
More badass here?
It was a syringe full of morphine. Yeah. And she has more balls than genetically engineered mice that are genetically engineered to not have balls.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Which, like, what's the point of those mice?
They're cloned mice just to test on.
That's disgusting.
I think that the whole point of bringing up that they didn't have any genitals was just so Doreen could make that one bad joke about her ex-husband. Like, I really... Yeah. I didn't see the point of that.
I mean, it's probably, it's just like makes it more science-y.
Yeah, and it just goes to show how far they're willing to go for their science, for their messed up science.
Horrible.
Bad science.
I just got three more things.
Okay.
It was great that the CDC was the one from Atlanta, and then you're like, oh, they blew that building up in The Walking Dead.
So obviously this takes place in the past.
Yes.
Obviously.
Maybe this is the pathogen that turns into the
walking. This is a prequel to The Walking Dead.
Oh, my God.
Oh, I love it.
Makes so much sense.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Also, the microchips in the hands.
Yes. An old trope.
Immediately, I was just like, okay, so that's how they're doing this. Yeah. And they don't seal off the doors once they know that it's, like, getting out. Apparently just cutting off someone's hand, which you'd think, okay, he's dead. We'll make it so his chip doesn't work anymore. Doesn't work.
Right.
And they use the exact same needle to insert it into everyone.
Needle.
It's like, hi, we're here with the CDC, and there's an infection, so let's use the exact same dirty needle to inject the chip into each of your hands.
Well, it could be that device has multiple needles ready.
Okay.
And it's self-cleaning, because this is the future.
Or the past.
2 days earlier.
It's a needle revolver, so it has like 6 shots in it that you can just like, it's a different needle every time.
And the third point, speaking of shots, Okay, there's four point. The third point, speaking of shots, okay, if you have people infected and things like that, people are going to start drinking and freaking out.
Mm-hmm.
And there's a lot less, there's a lot more order than I would assume there'd be at this place, because I know
we don't know
go-
what's going on with all the people in the other rooms. They could be all freaking out.
Well, for the, I'm sure we're going to have it develop as the season goes on and things like that, but I'm not sure. I think we're going to see a lot of like riots and people breaking against the rules, but where are the guns?
Yeah,
I know that I'm being so like picky for that.
Yeah, I don't understand your.
You put 100 people in a room and say that one person is infected with a contagious disease. What you better believe people are going to go crazy and you're going to need guns to calm people down.
What if there are no guns allowed in this facility? It could just be a rule of the facility, and the most advanced weapons that they have are these stun batons, which are very powerful.
Possibly. Oh, other thing too. And probably they're going to touch on this later, but if there's like over 100, what is it now? Like 100 and...
It's 121 staff
and there's
here
six
plus
people,
our CDC
people. Three survivors,
people.
Three are missing though.
Yeah.
Let's point out three are missing, which I also want to touch back on because I wonder where the heck they went.
We have a caller actually, so I'm going to patch them through. Caller, you're on the line with the Helix after show.
Hello?
Hi, you're on the line with the Helix after show.
Oh my God, Rose?
Yeah. Hey.
Thanks for calling in.
Do you have a question?
God.
What's your name?
Brittany.
Hey, Brittany. How you doing? I'm Matt.
I'm good. Hi, Matt.
Hey. So, what do you think of Helix?
Of what?
Helix, the show.
It's good.
Great. We think so, too. What do you want to talk about?
And they hung up. Helix is good.
Helix is good.
It is a very, it's a you very heard, fine show.
That's, you heard it here first.
Is AfterBuzz TV exclusive. Helix is good.
I'm sorry if you're calling again. I'm not taking your call.
But yeah. I want to bring up one
first
issue.
First prank call ever. Yeah.
I think she was just prank. Happy to say hi, guys.
Yeah. I mean, don't think she thought she would get through.
Yeah.
Well, you know what, Brittany? If that wasn't a prank call, you rock.
You
go
do.
You.
Keep and watching the show. Keep listening. Thank you.
Call in with questions, guys.
Yeah, questions are useful.
We'd love to hear from you. But I have a question.
Yeah, please.
For the CDC, do they not have backup? This seems like they're comparing it to Ebola. Mm-hmm. This is like new levels of virus.
Yeah.
They sort of established at the beginning when we see the CDC's like offices and everything. They're not a small organization.
Oh, no.
They have a table that's a square.
It takes up an entire room.
They sent, what, five people?
Here's the deal. Here's the deal. Until they know more, they're not going to risk more people's lives on this until they can figure stuff out. I imagine that by the time comes that they want to contact more people, they won't be able to because Dr. Hatake will get in the way of that.
I just had a total Starship Troopers moment. Like... This virus will turn you into a superhuman, make you insane. Would you like to know more?
Press one. Actually, yes. I just want to touch on that, though. I think the reason is, remember, this isn't in their jurisdiction, and they did say in the beginning of the show, well, Arctic Biosystems allowed the CDC to come in.
That's true.
So it may be they only sent a little amount of people because they weren't originally supposed to have clearance. It was a special, allowance for them to come. So obviously they didn't want to bring like a whole parade
again,
of people.
Which, again, why... who contacted them if Dr. Hatake didn't want them there?
That's the magical mystery question.
That's what I like about your theory about Peter being the one to infect himself then tell somebody he's infected.
Very clever. I like it.
It was smart.
Do you think he was planning on surviving? That's my question.
I think he was sacrificing himself and hoping that he would die. That's why I think he didn't want the water, because the water would make the thing grow. Instead of just letting him die.
And that's what's going on with his neck.
Yeah.
I do want to know, though, this white room that we were talking about before. Cream. Love it. They have Peter, enter the thing with the severed hand guys. You know, he gets into this lock. That's when he starts attacking people.
He ripped off someone's head.
Yeah.
Is gross. It?
That's what happened,
He ripped off a head and a hand.
Well, what happened was they said there were three survivors and there were three that were missing. So what I want to touch on is, was that the white room?
Here's what happened.
Okay.
So the three survivors were the people who were in containment with Sarah, And then the other three were like the one who attacked Doreen.
Ah.
They found another one, and then another one ran off
into
the snow.
That was Dr. Tracy who attacked Doreen.
Who got buried out there by Major Sergio. Well, he's got a notorious plot line now.
Well, no, that wasn't one of the infected. That was...
That was just some dude.
Just some doctor who wanted to get away and tell people what was going on.
I thought you just said doctor who wanted to get away, and I was very confused for 3 seconds.
I did say doctor who wanted to get away, but I didn't say doctor who wanted to get away.
Okay, don't get me excited for no reason. So there was... I kept on calling him the Seth Green lookalike.
I still don't see that comparison.
Steven saw it.
Okay.
Yeah.
He's in my side. But I just want to know, like, even if he meant to get away, first of all, like, where are you going? And secondly, it's the middle of the night. There's Arctic, like, temperature. I just want to know what that guy's plan was. Like, where were you going to go?
Run like hell.
Okay. Well, I have a... You're gonna hate me because I'm going to throw out another theory right here.
Uh-oh.
Please.
What if he was infected?
Yo.
Oh, my God. He got to the snowmobile. He was trying to get away. He was trying to get to find more people.
But I just don't know when he didn't show any infected.
Like, but they show so many specific signs. I don't think that could have happened.
He wasn't even sweating.
Yeah.
Yo, man, don't sweat it.
I mean, we still don't know the limits of this virus. I'm just honestly, I just want to keep going.
I know
that's why
I think it's time we go into predictions because we're just gonna be speculating.
Let's go into predictions.
Let's do this.
Yeah.
And now you're after Buzz TV predictions.
Okay, so. We've got all these mysteries. We've got the white room. We've got who called the CDC. We don't know what this virus is.
What is up with Hitake's eyes?
Yes. Who is he? How does he know who Julia is?
Why is he obsessed with her?
What is the point of the virus? What is the goal there?
Who does number two work for?
Yes.
Well, I think once we find out who Hitake and, you know, this guy Sergio is working for, if he is truly with the army, because they did this whole background with him.
Yes. And then also, the biggest mystery of all, of course, is when are Alan and Sarah going to totally bang? Because that's going to happen.
Of course.
You don't see Dr. Hitake and Sarah?
No. No, he's like totally obsessed with Julia.
Oh, not Sarah. Julia. That's what I meant.
Yeah, no,
sorry.
That's going to happen.
Sorry, I mixed up the names.
Yeah, no.
First episode, guys. Forgive me. It happens.
It happens.
No. Well, she has to be infected for a reason.
Yes.
Well, she's infected, and then if Hitake is infected, then, you know, there could be some serious infection sexiness going on. I don't
know. Ew.
Who knows how the infection procreates?
Well, it's like, but here's the thing, right? This virus is almost like an allegory for sexual assault almost, because it's oral contact, it's forced, it's really invasive and violating.
Oh yeah,
it's
even
gross.
Even the one scientist, the lady who was in the contained room with Sarah, was saying, "I've never felt so violated." I mean, it's kind of violent.
It's very violent.
You know, but I think what's going to happen is, I think, you know, what Steven predicted, you know, why isn't there a freaking gun? Because there's going to be
mass chaos. Saw in the preview for what's coming up this season, we saw a bunch of dudes in white suits with guns.
Okay.
Rifles, in fact.
I blinked at that part.
Yeah.
In the white suits.
With big guns. Rifles. They'll kill everyone. You. Yeah.
I think the white room reminds me of snow for some reason. Like, because they're in Antarctica.
You know nothing, snow.
No.
Oh, my God. I mean, there's got to be something about it being in Antarctica. Because they could do this literally anywhere.
Say
like, you could put this show...
Antarctica again.
Antarctica.
Good pronunciation. Well, it's a virus. They have to have it in a cold place because you figure if it gets out, it makes sense for it to be in Antarctica because the freezing cold temperatures would probably
kill
most viruses.
But there's so many like throwbacks to like old horror in the show.
Totally.
I mean, with the thing was in Antarctica.
Yep.
It took on the humans or whatever.
Yeah.
And then it tried to escape to get to more humans.
In the thing, they found it buried in the ice and we talk briefly about in that scene between Julia and Sarah about ice samples that have diseases that are more than 140,000 years old. So I think that's kind of the riff, and that's why it's in the Arctic. Yeah.
And then I also wanted to throw that, because we're doing predictions, you know, I'm just throwing out all the things that I think are going to happen. There's great horror manga out there that's kind of based with this kind of thing in mind, and a lot of them are like stations at the bottom of the ocean, like... There was a terrible movie called Sphere that did this.
Yes.
And I kind of got that feeling whenever it does like the drop down shot of the outside of the base and everything. And I really think in the next few episodes we're going to see power outages.
Mm-hmm.
We're going to see there's going to be some environmental factor that makes it so nobody can reach them.
Mm-hmm.
They even mentioned it. They said, hey, the helicopter has to get out of here because once it gets below negative 70, it turns the gas to jelly. So we're going to see a cold front move in that's going to be there for weeks at a time to prevent other people from interfering.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And there's,
or even just days at a time, because that's the majority of a season. Like, 1 week is over half of a season.
No,
of this
but
show.
You got to realize any movie or any show that's like cabin fever-ish,
right.
That's why it started with day one.
Oh yeah, yeah. They also
it's
mentioned
seclusion.
Mm-hmm. They also mentioned that the satellite that they know they have, not the one
they
that Sergio planted,
1 hour a day.
It's only 1 hour each day. It's super fast to be able to upload everything within that hour that they need. But there's only that, so that's like a total foreshadowing. They're just going to be completely cut off from everything. So,
and then they've shown it us a little bit, and I'm really really hoping that they go in this direction that I'm hoping because they have the jump cuts.
Yeah.
And they have like the blur, like every shot is somebody blurry walking
so
into.
So many jump cuts.
And I really want them to go full horror on this show. Like, yeah. I really, really want them to have like the jump cuts be really creepy, like a frame of something that's really terrifying and things like that.
Yeah.
Because I.
Some good jump scares.
Exactly.
Oh, yeah.
I want that.
I have a prediction.
Go for
okay.
it.
Okay. So it's like black sludge, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. We have Peter. And he's jumping around like Spider-Man, or so that's what Sarah's exact words were when he climbed the cage.
Oh, yeah.
I think it's Venom. Probably
oh,
wrong.
Boo.
Sorry. You guys.
I think we're going to end up seeing Sergio. I think he's going to be a good guy as we move forward.
Maybe.
Yeah.
I mean, he's going to be a good guy with some bad methods, burying a guy out in the
right.
snow. But I think we're going to find out.
Yeah, it was.
Yeah.
Sergio killed
the plumber. Yep. The plumber, yeah. The he's plumber. The army guy.
Oh, God. Yep. I thought it was Dan this whole time.
No,
I'm
Daniel's
sorry, Dan.
The security guy.
Army guy just murdered a dude and yeah. left him out
no,
in the snow.
No, I agree. He's well, first of all, he's going to reveal at some point that he's not who he says he is. And then it will take a long time for him to regain the trust of Alan and Sarah and Doreen.
Well, oh. I don't
and
trust
Julia.
The corporation involved here.
Oh yeah, no, they're the worst.
This is a Resident Evil throwback. You got the guy who plays the normal part and ends up as somebody on the payroll, but then he realizes what's going wrong and he turns into the good guy. Because he's with the army who's buying this stuff for like warfare and things like that.
Or so we assume.
But Hatake has his own plans and
right.
Sergio doesn't know about that. Yeah. I don't think he knows about that.
No.
I think the only one who knows about that is Daniel and Hatake himself.
I agree. They're the only ones who are very much
and
on
Dan.
The inside circle. That's what we were talking about, Hatake and Dan.
Oh.
Yeah.
I keep on mixing up Sergio and Dan. I apologize,
it's okay.
guys. First episode.
Here. Dan is fat, and Sergio
is
not.
Leave
him alone, man.
No! He is a bad guy, and I can say whatever I want because he's bad.
And he has a bad haircut.
Okay.
So are we shipping Doreen, y'all?
Is that what we're calling it?
Daniel and Doreen.
I will. No, not Daniel and Doreen. We were. I mean, it was more Sergio and Doreen, but we do have... Jorgut, which is Rachel Jordan and Alan Farragut.
Hashtag Jorgut.
Hashtag Jorgut.
Trying to figure out right. with it.
Okay, I think that's going to cover it for this week's after show. Thank you all so much for listening. Liz Richmaury, where can the people find you?
The people can find me on Twitter. You can find me at Lizzie Maui, LizzyMawy.
Okay.
And tweet me about the show, and just follow me.
All right. Zach Wilson, where can the people find you?
You can find me on Twitter at ThatZachWilson. That's Zach with a C-H. And you can also catch me on the Almost Human, Grim, and Archer podcast at AfterBuzz.
All right. Stephen Lemieux, where can the people find you?
You can find me here on Tuesday nights doing the Sleepy Hollow After Show, as well as on Twitter at Stephen Lemieux, StephenLemieux. Or you can just look right there, and you'll see the spelling. Yeah.
All right.
Longest
And you can find me on Twitter at Matt Lieberman. That's MattLieberman. I'm kind of everywhere here at AfterBuzz TV, so I'm just going to give a long list. It might not be everything, but just tune in all the time. I'm doing Almost Human, Sleepy Hollow, only 2 episodes left. Tune in for those. We got Marvel's Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D., Lost Girls starting up soon. Banshee is a great show. If you're not watching, you should totally watch that. Sherlock coming up next Sunday. Got Cougar Town cooking. And Betas is wrapping up its season in 2 weeks. If you haven't seen that show, definitely do it. You can get a free month of Amazon Prime at amazon.com/freemonth and watch that show. It's about to finish its run, and it's so funny. Highly recommended. Thank you all so much for joining us. We will be back next week with an all-new episode. I know that episode 3 is already available online, so if you want to watch it now, you totally can.
Check with your cable provider.
Yes. And now that we've heard the longest outro ever.
Yes. But
love you, Matt.
Love you, too. All right.
From executive producers Maria Menounos, Kevin Undergaro, Phil Svitek, and the entire AfterBuzz TV staff, we would like to thank you for listening to the AfterBuzz TV Network. To watch or listen to other after shows and post comments or questions, be sure to visit AfterBuzzTV.com. I'm Sir Richard Wentworth, and this has been a presentation of AfterBuzz TV.
Infect you later!
The views expressed herein are those of the hosts only and do not necessarily reflect the views of AfterBuzz TV or its owners or principals.
Thank you for watching AfterBuzz TV on YouTube. For more of your favorite after shows and interviews, subscribe to our channel here and be sure to share your opinion on the episode in the comment section below here. We'd love to see what you guys are buzzing about. Thanks again. Buzz you later.